here's what's happening. Archaeological discoveries now are being made that precede that 5,000 year cycle. So when it first started happening, scientists said, oh, well, these are anomalies. So, you know, we've got our history and we're sure it's right. And then here's an anomaly and we'll put it over here. We'll come back and look at it later. Well, now there are so many anomalies. The anomalies are telling the new stories.
I'd like to welcome back to the show, returning champion, Gregg Braden. How are you doing, Gregg?
Hey, well, thank you for that warm introduction. It's good to start as a champion today. I'm doing well. I am coming to you as before from our studio just outside of Santa Fe, New Mexico. And I've got to tell you, this day with you is the first day in 2 weeks we haven't seen rain and snow. So you brought sunshine to the high desert. I'm happy to be with you.
I'm glad I could help you, sir. I'm glad I could help you. Our last conversation was such a hit with our audience. And I think we made plans right after our first conversation, even before that other one was released. We're like, we got to keep talking. I have to come back. We have to make something happen. So I know you're a very busy man. I appreciate you coming back on the show. And today's conversation really wanted to tackle something that you know a little bit about in regards to ancient civilizations, technologies of ancient civilization, spirituality in that space as well.
Sure.
So I'll just start with a very easy question. Who built the pyramids?
Well, so I'll start with an easy answer to lay a foundation.
Sure.
To the answer to that question, if I can. You know, when I was in school back in the Midwest of this big, beautiful country we live in, 1950s, 1960s, I was taught at that time what we are still teaching our children today, and that is that civilization began in an isolated location in what today we call the Tigris-Euphrates Valley. Mm-hmm. And it began in a primitive state and evolved in a linear fashion, slowly, gradually, over a long period of time, to what we have today. The problem with that story, Alex, is the evidence doesn't support it. And there is still there's a battle to maintain what is called the standard model when it comes to our history, when it comes to civilization, when it comes to science, when it comes to physics, when it comes to human origins. There's a battle to maintain this static story. Excuse me, it was developed, you know, in late 1800s, early 1900s, even though the evidence no longer supports it. So the new discoveries are now telling us that rather than a single cradle of civilization, excuse me, in the Tigris-Euphrates, rather than a single cradle, that there now appear to have been at least five simultaneous cradles of civilization. And some of those are very familiar to us. There was one in China. There was one in the Tigris-Euphrates. That was Mesopotamia. There is the Indus Valley, mysterious technology has been found buried in the Indus Valley and what now is India and Pakistan. There was Corral in northern Peru. There was Mesoamerica. There was the area in what we now call the UK and Europe and that part of the world. So these five, or depending on how you look at them, maybe six simultaneous civilizations. Oh, and Egypt. Egypt was certainly a part of that. And this is a long answer to your question. They appear to have been simultaneous. There appears to be a communication. There's a continuity of knowledge between these civilizations in terms of agriculture, the ability to grow large amounts of food in hostile environments to feed large populations, certainly mathematics. Certainly architecture, multi-story buildings. It's no easy feat to build these multi-story structures the way they were built. And a knowledge of the cosmos that was so advanced, Alex, in many instances, it was discounted as myth until the 20th century when our own satellites began telling us more about the neighborhood that we live in, our solar system neighborhood. And lo and behold, these ancient traditions had it right on. So the question that comes up often is, where did these civilizations come from? And I think the answer to that question may be the answer to who built the pyramids. So that's why I wanted to lay that foundation.
Thank you.
What we know is that I'm a geologist by degree, and I rarely get to use that degree anymore. With a strong background in the life sciences, math, physics, computer science, cosmology, and archaeology. And I say that once again because it's that multidisciplinary background that helps me to stay current in many different fields as new fields of science, as new discoveries are being revealed. And I got to tell you, what we're going to talk about in this program, it's no secret in the scientific community. It is simply there's a resistance to embracing it in the mainstream. So mainstream textbooks, mainstream classrooms. And the reason is because the pushback from the religious community, from the political community, certainly from the technological community, and much more. So what I'm saying to you is peer reviewed. It's out there in the open literature. It's just not something that we often hear about. So the mystery is, where did those simultaneous advanced civilizations come from? And that might be where we want to go with this, but I'm going to, mm-hmm. I'll stop there and see if it makes sense and where you'd like to go.
Yeah, I would love, let's dive into where these ancient civilizations come from, because it is such a mystery anyone who has a logical mind to even look at the pyramids and believe the story that we've been told. It just doesn't make logical sense.
Let's talk about the pyramids for a little bit. I had my first opportunity. I had studied the pyramids since I was a kid. You know, I've been fascinated by this stuff. I was 5 years old. My mom was helping me to read books by Edgar Cayce about mm-hmm. lost civilizations. And we were memorizing the planets in the solar system and the names of the dinosaurs and the kings of Egypt. So I've been fascinated by this stuff for a very long time. My first journey into Egypt was 1986. and I was just astounded by what I saw. Now, that was a very different Egypt from what we see today. There are a lot of places now that are restricted, and they have been revamped, for public consumption. It was much more raw back in the 1980s, 1990s. But the pyramid, and we talk about pyramids, there are pyramids all over the world. And it's the similarity of those pyramids that brings to mind the question, where did they come from? But typically when people talk about pyramids, they're talking about three pyramids on the Giza Plateau in Egypt. And interestingly, the largest of those is called the Great Pyramid, and it's not the one that people show in the pictures. Because the Great Pyramid does not have a capstone. It's flat on top. That capstone was lost at mm-hmm. some point in history. There's another one of the three that does have a capstone, and that's the one that the news anchors and television and movies, they always call that the Great Pyramid, and it's not. Mm-hmm. But there are so many, we could do a whole program on the mysteries of that single structure alone. It's over 400 feet tall. It is made of massive blocks of limestone. When I was there, I went back in 1989, and there was a scientific group that was trying to recreate the Great Pyramid. And the first thing that they discovered was that none of the equipment, they were using caterpillar tractors and forklifts and things like that. None of the equipment that we had at that time could lift the blocks, the 20-ton blocks of the pyramid. So they had to go to the Caterpillar tractor company and have commissioned them to build a special device that they then could use to build the pyramid. And after 6 months, the Egyptian government told them to clean up their mess and go home. They simply could not replicate the technology. The way, when we see that pyramid, what we're seeing actually is a part of the structure that was never meant to be seen. So there were essentially three layers of the pyramids of Giza and the Great mm-hmm. Pyramid. The outer layer was encased in highly polished limestone, looked like marble, a white that would have reflected that light in just a magnificent way. And there are only a few layers of that left on one side at the bottom because it has been stripped away for convenience used in other buildings throughout Cairo, in other mosques, and other primarily in other mosques and other structures that are there. So what we're seeing now is the inside that was never meant to be seen. And these are the tiered limestone blocks, and inside of that was built around the rooms themselves are granite, the king's chamber, the queen's chamber, a massive, you know, 50, 60, 70 ton blocks that are so highly polished. We can't do this with our technology today. They're less than 1/1000th of an inch of tolerance between the stones. And there's no mortar holding these together, and they've been there for centuries. The mathematics involves the mathematics of circumference of the earth and the diameter of the earth and the earth's relationship to the moon, our relationship to the magnetic fields of the planet. I mean, it goes on and on and on. So the question is, how was it done? And obviously these were not primitive people that were doing this. Right. So when I was there in 1989, another scientific group was there, and they were given access. This is the only time this has ever happened. They were given access to the casing stones that we see today and permission to drill core samples into those casing stones, because when you do that, you're destroying the stone. So I mean, part of it. So obviously it's not happening a lot. So they took the core samples, and I was a geologist. Yeah. What you would expect to see if these were naturally occurring limestone blocks taken from the surrounding limestone in the area, there's a lot of limestone in the area, you would expect in those core samples to see what you see in naturally occurring limestone. You would expect laminations, you would expect microfossils, maybe visible fossils, because it was presumably from ocean bottom. And what they found in the core samples was just the opposite of that. There were no laminations. The entire block appears to be homogeneous. That's not what you see in nature when nature is laying those, year layers. After year after yeah. year, the layers that go down. But they also found air bubbles, they found insects, and they found human hair. And what they, when they did the chemical analysis, there were chemicals in the blocks that do not occur naturally. So the bottom line, I mean, this is a mind blower. This is 1989 when they found this. It is the question, how did they get massive blocks of such high tolerance fitting perfectly 400 feet above the surface? And, you know, I mean, if you watch the old movies and Charlton Heston, you know, and Exodus, what you see is, you know, a million slaves with ropes and log rollers, and they're rolling them up sand ramps and all that, you know, and maybe that happened in some places later on. That very possibly could have happened later on, but that's not what happened with the three pyramids, the great pyramids on Giza. And what they found was, and what was published, and the pushback was tremendous, is that these stones are what are called, they're artificial stone. And the way they were created is they were, in fact, the stone itself was mined from nearby limestone quarries. It was then pulverized and mixed with a high-tech epoxy that allowed it to be plastic, you know, kind of molten, or at least, you know, soft, poured into molds. And then those molds, it was hardened. And the molds were poured on site. So that's why you could pour one block next to another and get 1/1000th of an inch tolerance. So, you know, and I talk to people about this. I used to do a lot of programs on this, not so much anymore. But one of the questions people say, okay, well, you know, what's the big deal? Artificial stone. Well, we didn't know really how to create this. There's another interesting story that goes with this. In 1990, some of our viewers remember, the U.S. was about to invade Iraq in what was called the first Gulf War. I remember watching on TV. I was crying watching on TV. I didn't want to see it happen. Yeah. And there's a backstory to this. Saddam Hussein knew that America would, well, everybody knew because we broadcast that we were going to attack. He contacted an American artist who was using the technology that was used in the Great Pyramids, he contacted that artist because he wanted that technology to harden his bunkers before the U.S. forces attacked Iraq. He wanted that the epoxy-based stone so that he could harden those bunkers. And the U.S. got wind of this, U.S. government, and made it illegal. They forbade the artist from sharing his patented technology with Saddam Hussein that would have actually hardened those bunkers against the shock and awe that, that we were doing. So the point is the technology that was used to build the pyramids was so advanced. We weren't even really doing it until the 20th century. And it had military applications that were recognized pretty quickly.
And we still don't do it. And we still aren't using it heavily in our construction or anything like that right now.
No, not in. There are some artists that are using this, but you don't see it in construction. So this was a mind blower to the scientific community in 1989, because all the textbooks say those blocks were carved and then somehow mysteriously moved into place. Now we go down just adjacent to the Giza Plateau is the Great Sphinx. And I know most of our viewers are familiar with the Sphinx. And as a geologist, I was fascinated when I went there in 86, because what you see on the back of the Sphinx, on the rump, and this is a view that you don't often get in, you know, in mainstream. They're always looking either a profile or right on at the face. But what you see is there. First of all, the Sphinx is carved from in place from a limestone bluff that was in place. So it's like there was a solid limestone bluff, and the Sphinx was carved, and then all the empty space around it is where the rock was cleared and moved away to so that the Sphinx looks like this isolated standing mm-hmm. structure. So it was actually carved in place. When you go around to the back of the Sphinx on the rump, you see erosion marks that are about 12 feet deep in some places. And it's limestone. Limestone's a sedimentary rock. And when there are some parts of the limestone that are more resistant than others, and the softer parts are what get eroded away, creating these erosion marks. Well, There is a geologist from Boston University, Robert Schalk, and I know many people are familiar with his work now, because of the Charlton Heston special. Charlton Heston did a special on the Great Sphinx. And Robert Schalk was the first one that credibly questioned the age of the Sphinx from a geologic perspective. And what he did was he looked at those erosion marks, the same ones I'm looking at, and he said, well, this is obviously fluvial erosion. The term fluvial means high, it's based in water. And it would take high amounts of water moving quickly over long periods of time to create that kind of erosion. Up until that time, the scientists had called it aeolian erosion, which means it was wind blowing, mm-hmm. Sand like sandpaper and cutting it away. Robert Schalk said, no, it's obvious. This is fluvial erosion. And here's where the kicker comes in. The only time that there has been that kind of water, high amounts, fast moving water over long periods of time, predates anything our textbooks are talking about when it comes to the pyramids. We're told the pyramids were built approximately 4,500, maybe 5,000 years ago. And the water that would be required for that erosion has not been seen since the melting of the ice at the end of the last ice age, which is right around between, around 12, 13,000 years BP before present. Mm-hmm. So if that is the case, it means the structure had to already be existing at 12 to 13,000 BP. It had to be older than that. And this is where the problems are coming in today. Now, as a geologist, I was a member of a geologic organization, AAPG, American Association of Petroleum Geologists was mm-hmm. the term, but it's about more than petroleum. And they have a journal, a peer-reviewed journal that comes out. Robert Schalk published his findings in AAPG And the scientists, the real scientists, not the pop scientists, they looked at that data and they said, of course, this is fluvial erosion. Of course, it had to have happened, 12, 13,000 years before present. They accepted it, no problem. The geologists have no problem. The historians have a horrible problem because it means the history is wrong. And the evidence no longer supports the history.
And what I find fascinating, Gregg, is that the pyramids, which were supposed to be the oldest of all of them, it seems to two things. One, it was said it was a king's chamber. Yet there has never been, there's nothing that's ever proven that at all. They've never found a corpse. There's no hieroglyphs. It completely goes against every other tomb we've ever found. And two, it seems that the technology keeps getting worse. So the pyramids, as they get closer to our time period, seem to degrade almost in the style that they're being built. They should be getting better, and there should be more of them out there, right?
Well, it is true, Alex, and it's something, this is not isolated. Well, first, I'm just going to back up. The way that they have dated the pyramids, you cannot date something that has not been alive. You can only carbon date something that has been living, breathing oxygen, carbon-based life. So stone cannot be carbon dated. The way that they have dated these pyramids is by estimating through, who was the king at what period of time and, whose face is on a statue or something like that. And then here, I mean, this makes no sense at all. They also have found mice and rats inside the pyramid that are dead and mummified, and they carbon date those dead mice and rats. They might date to 4,000 or 5,000 years before present. There is nothing linking that dead rat to the origin of the pyramid. I mean, the rat could have come in 1,000 years ago, inside of the pyramid. But this is where the scientific community, they've got a story and they want to stick with it. And this is what I said at the beginning, there's a battle for what is called the standard model. And they had this all nice and buttoned up, nice and tidy, about the kings and the eras. So where all this is leading, if the Sphinx was already existing when the ice melted, and if the Great Pyramid was made using technology and incorporating mathematics that are so sophisticated, We didn't know it until recently. Where did that come from? All of this is pointing to, and it's something I've talked about extensively, is that civilization appears to be cyclic rather than linear. So the linear model is what we're teaching our kids. We began ancient Sumeria, Mesopotamia, 5,000, 5,500 years ago. And, then you've got, Rome and Greece and all of that. Well, all of that happens to have occurred within the most recent cycle that began about 5,000 years ago. And what the mathematics, what the archaeology is showing is that our history appears to be closely correlated to 5,125-year-long cycles. And there are 5,125-year cycles that make up one big cycle called a precession of the equinox. And I know some of our astronomers and astrologers are familiar with that. It's about 26,000 years. It is related to the way that Earth relates to the sun and to the way that I don't want to get too deep with all of this, but our relationship to our solar system and the Milky Way. And if those of you that remember the 2012 phenomenon, that's what this was all about. 2012 was the end of the fifth 5,125-year-long cycle and the beginning of a new age, a new cycle that we're in right now. So when you plot that out, I didn't know we were going to talk about this. I would have brought some slides. Mm-hmm. When you plot that out on a graph, when you look at these 5,000-year cycles, so here we are today, 2012, the beginning of a new cycle, or the end of one that began 5,000 years ago. Well, here's what's happening. Archaeological discoveries now are being made that precede that 5,000 year cycle. So when it first started happening, scientists said, "Oh, well, these are anomalies." So, you know, we've got our history and we're sure it's right. And then here's an anomaly and we'll put it over here. We'll come back and look at it later. Well, now there are so many anomalies. The anomalies are telling the new story. So you've got places like the Gulf of Kambat in India. It's a 3 mile long, 5 mile wide submerged city. It's under 120 feet of water, 9,500 years before present. Very sophisticated archaeology. We've got Göbekli Tepe in Turkey that is still being excavated and is now over 13,000 years before present. Now that the ice is melting in Antarctica, the satellites are showing complex, massive, complex structures. These aren't like little log cabins or, you know, pit houses. I mean, these are massive structures. The ice has been there for 20,000 years. So the question is, who was building complex architectural structures 20,000 years ago in Antarctica? Well, when you plot those, what you're finding is Rome and Greece and Corral, Peru. That is the most recent 5,000-year cycle. So what we've been studying and what we've been teaching ourselves and our children is not the history of the world forever. It's the history of the world in the most recent cycle. Now we've got to start looking the 5,000-year cycle before that, where we see Corral in Peru, which is now dated. It's the oldest technologically advanced civilization in all of the Americas. It's older than the Inca, than the Aztec, than the Olmec, than the Toltec. It's older than anything. We've got to rewrite all the history books. And next to it, another site has been found that's even older. We're told civilization began 5,000 years ago. That's when these ended. These civilizations ended when we're told that civilization began. So that's a 5,000-year cycle. Now you go back and you look at Göbekli Tepe. So we've got today back to about 5,000 years. 5,000 years to 10,000 years is another 5,000-year cycle. And that's, you know, all the things, Çatalhöyük in Turkey and Corral and all those. Now we're looking at Göbekli Tepe, 13,000. So now we're looking at another 5,000-year cycle, and now we're looking at Antarctica, another 5,000-year cycle. So the evidence strongly supports cyclic civilization, and the question is, what happens every 5,000 years? Why do those civilizations, why do we lose the memory, lose the knowledge of those civilizations, and what happened before those five or six simultaneous civilizations? Where did they come from? Where did the knowledge for those come from? And all of it leads to the understanding that there have been great catastrophes in our past. And one of those now is hotly contested, but the evidence is very strong for a comet impact during what is called the Pleistocene geologic era. As we were coming out of the last ice age, and that comet plunged us back into an ice age, and that brought an end to a great advanced civilization that existed on Earth. The remnants from that became those five simultaneous civilizations. The remnants became, you know, the pyramids in Egypt and China and Indus Valley and all that. And this is why they had such similar mathematics, architecture, cosmology, and things like that. So we just covered a whole lot of ground. I'll stop and let's fill in the missing pieces here.
Well, I mean, I've studied, I'm assuming you obviously know about the yugas and the yuga cycles from from the yogi Sukhteswar, who wrote and he literally laid out exactly what you're saying, the 26,000 year cycle. And the way they lay it out is that there is advanced knowledge, then we lose it, then we come back to it, and everywhere between there's like little jumps here and there. And we're now on an upward swing towards our new cycle is obviously we're advancing. technologically we're advancing, spiritually even we're advancing, even the last, hopefully in the last 30 or 40 years, how much we've advanced. It is a fascinating idea to think about what is, where we were coming from. And I don't want to get into why everyone's fighting this and in the status quo, but it's ego and other things like that. But the main one question I'd love to talk to you about, because it has not really been talked about publicly a lot, Antarctica. I've mm-hmm. seen these satellite images of these massive structures that could arguably, they say, pyramids that are bigger than the Great, much bigger than the Great. Tell me what you've learned.
No, I've seen them as well. So Antarctica is a mystery for a number of reasons. Number one, it is supposed to be international property that no one owns. And there were agreements signed in the early 20th century that it would not be militarized. We signed those same agreements for space, and we signed them for the moon, and both of those have been violated. We have militarized space. We have weapons in space. And there's a lot of controversy about what has been done on the lunar surface and how it's been done. The same goes with Antarctica. We know that China has their military base, Germany has theirs, Russia has theirs, the United States has theirs. We've obviously militarized Antarctica. What has happened since global warming, and as a geologist, I'll just say straight up, global warming is a fact. We've been talking about, we were giving people a heads up that we should be moving into a warming cycle. Humans didn't cause it. We've contributed to it, but if there are no humans, we would still be, the geologic record shows, you know, we would still be in a warming cycle. Mm-hmm. So the warming is happening, and it is melting this 2 miles of ice that has been there for about 20,000 years. And as that began to happen, it began to expose these complex structures. Now, one of the first things I learned as a student of archaeology is that nature never builds in 90 degree angles.
Right.
And, you know, you won't see a river like coming down and then, you know, doing one of these things. And you don't see wind eroding in a 90 degree angle. So one of the first things you look for, if you're looking on another planet, or if you're looking, you know, for lost civilizations here on Earth, as you begin looking for these evidence of 90 degree angles in architecture. And what began showing up in Antarctica, and again, this isn't like a little one room pit house. These are massive complex structures with room after room after room after room, within rooms. And once those, this was around 2016, 2017, then Google Earth pixelated all of that out. And if you go to look at Antarctica right now, you will not see any of that. However, I've got pre-pixelated images showing where you can compare the same areas. So they don't want us seeing what it is that is there.
Why? Why is
my sense? Well, a couple of reasons. First of all, it messes up the story. Remember, there's a battle. There's a battle for what's called the standard model of history. The standard model says we began primitive about 5,000 years ago. And slowly, gradually, we've evolved into the pinnacle of sophistication that we have today. And it's only happened once. What the cyclic model shows is that there are different kinds of technologies, Alex. And you can have an advanced technology and not have it based in transistors and resistors. There are other kinds of technologies. And my sense is that if these technologies... So I'm going to go back as a geologist once again. The catastrophic event theory that now has a lot of evidence of a comet impact. So I'll just lay the ground here. Here's what was happening. We were coming in the Pleistocene. We were coming out of the Ice Age, and Earth was beginning to warm as it would cyclically. All of a sudden, and this is quick, you see this drop where the temperatures on the planet drop quickly, and we plunge into another ice age. But what also happens during that time is there's a rapid rise in sea levels that are happening at the same time. Mm-hmm. it doesn't make a lot of sense until you begin to look at the evidence. It appears that this comet that impacted, scientists have been resistant to accept this theory because they'd say for something that big, it'd have to leave a big hole in the ground. They're assuming it was one piece that hit Earth. What we now know is there were some big pieces, and they have now found the craters in Greenland and Newfoundland, but now they have found hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of smaller craters all the way from Greenland and Newfoundland, all the way down across Europe, down into South Africa. And when they go to do the geologic testing of the craters, what they find are high amounts of standalone platinum. This is important because, first of all, platinum is a rare element to begin with. When you find it on Earth, it is generally with another mineral called iridium. Iridium is a transition metal in the platinum family. There is no iridium, suggesting, and scientists now, they say this in the open literature, this is of extraterrestrial origin. It's not terrestrial geology. It's out, it's incoming. Mm-hmm. So this comet broke up and scattered hundreds and hundreds, maybe thousands of these craters. And when that happened, the ice in the northern hemisphere, most of North America, most of Northern Europe, northern latitudes was covered in ice. There's what was called an ice wall that was holding back large amounts of water that was from the melt. This comet brought a rapid, intense heat that was enough to melt that ice wall. And there was a rapid infusion of water. So first of all, it was it had a different salinity than the ocean, different temperature. It infused into the Atlantic. And we can see this. We have records of this. Sea levels rose in some places 200 feet. If you can imagine, a 200-foot sea level rise.
So Disney World's gone. Disney World's gone, essentially.
Oh, man. Well, most of the coastal areas are gone. And so all of this happened in a really, really very compressed period of time during a mysterious time called the Drier Yugas. Mm-hmm. The Younger Dryas. We were talking about the Hindu Yugas. It's called the Younger Dryas. Dryas is the name of a flower that you typically see in certain climatic conditions. And when that flower began to appear in the ways that it did, that was where this came from. So there's a little period of time called the Younger Dryas. My friend, I have a couple of friends that have done a lot of documentation on this. And, you know, there's some pushback on it. If people watch any of the video Netflix series or anything mm-hmm. like that, you know, they're talking about Graham Hancock has done the Netflix series. I don't know if you saw this last mm-hmm. week. The Archaeological Association is now petitioning to have the series. If Netflix is going to hold it, they would prefer they not show it. If they're going to show it, they want them to reclassify it from a documentary. They don't want it called a documentary. They now want to call it science fiction. Because it is now the most popular and most viewed episode or series on Netflix. And it's giving a lot of people a lot of ideas about our past. So it changes the story. But now back to Antarctica. And the reason I talked about the influx of the water and the dropping of the temperature quickly, if this was a highly advanced, technologically sophisticated civilization, the change that we saw happened so quickly, there's a good chance that whatever technology they were using is still there. It was preserved. They didn't have time to cart it away or anything. I mean, this is a very quick event. And that technology threatens the status quo of the technology that we have today. Obsolete technologies like internal combustion engines and the burning of fossil fuels to create energy. I mean, those have served us, and we have made great advancements based upon that. And we are at a point now where I'm amazed that we're still using internal combustion energy and still burning stuff to, you know, to create that kind of energy. So I think this is the reason that they're trying to cover this up. You know, there was a film crew from Los Angeles. There was some university students and there were some professionals that went down to document what was happening, and they have not been heard from since. They've disappeared. Their families suspect that they have found some of these bases and are simply...
And we're in Antarctica? In Antarctica?
Yeah, in Antarctica. That they are being held. They're not... they don't know that they have died, but they, if they were successful in finding the bases, they probably would not have been allowed to leave. So, Antarctica, a lot of mystery happening around Antarctica, and there's a lot of diversion away from that. Mainstream doesn't want to talk about it. They've been told not to talk about that. So,
well, let me ask you this, because the Younger Dryas, which, yeah, Graham Hancock is doing the Lord's work in many ways, doing what he's doing over these years, and that documentary series has been, it's kind of like ignited a whole conversation about this.
Yeah.
But the Antarctica stuff has not been talked about too much. If there is these structures that are being shown after the melt, how, because we're not, this is beyond the Younger Dryas. This is deep into Antarctica. So that means that's been there for a long period of time. What is your estimation?
Well, this is where it gets really interesting. Where is there a mother civilization or a father civilization, depending on how you want to look at this? Indigenous traditions. I for over 40 years, I've led groups into the Andes of southern Peru. Actually, in September, we're getting ready to take, it'll be my 39th trip in 36 years.
Nice.
Into Peru. We haven't been since COVID. It's been the indigenous. Yeah, the indigenous populations have not had really much outside contact since COVID. Their traditions, whether we're talking about the Southern Andes or we're talking about the Aboriginals or in Papua New Guinea or Australia or New Zealand or, the American Desert Southwest, the Navajo, the Hopi, they all talk about previous worlds. They all say that they are the remnant that emerged from a previous civilization. And they almost universally, all of the stories, as different as the traditions are from one another, they all tell the story of the Great Flood. Presumably this flood is the resulting of a rapid melting of the ice and the rising of the sea levels. And what that does is when the ice, there was a time about 30% during the Pleistocene, about 30% of the surface area of the earth was covered in ice. And what that does, where that ice comes from, it's seawater. If it's not in the sea, that means the sea levels are lower because the water's locked up in the ice. If the water is lower, it is exposing land that connects continents, land bridges, like between Alaska and Siberia, for example, where humans could presumably walk. And the same
Philippines
is happening.
Yeah, the Philippines Islands were all big landmass.
Exactly. So when you go back far enough, the indigenous traditions talk about a continent, and there are different names for this. We've all heard of these. We've heard of Lemuria in the Pacific. James Churchward in late 1800s, early 1900s, linked that with the lost continent of Mu, which would have extended from Hawaii is the high part that remains above water today, down to the Malaysian islands to the west, and then down to Easter Island to the south. Those were all part of this massive continent and an advanced civilization in the Pacific. On the Atlantic side, of course, we hear about Atlantis and the technology and what happened there. Well, as a geologist, is interesting because on the Atlantic side, where Plato says Atlantis was, is exactly at a place where three of the continental plates come. It's a triple junction for the continental plates: the African plate, the North American plate, and the northern plate to the side. When those plates come together, not only are they often subducted, one goes under another. Like right now, the Pacific plate is being subducted by the North American plate. And that means the Pacific plate is moving underneath North America to the east. So I'm in New Mexico, just outside of Santa Fe, Colorado Rockies, the mountain ranges that we see, but that is the leading edge of the Pacific plate. So in other words, if I drilled far enough down from my studio right now, I would actually hit the Pacific plate because it's being subducted. Mm-hmm. That happens sometimes. What also happens is at a triple junction like this is there's an undulation that happens over time. And both of those appear to be what is happening, precisely the place where Atlantis was said to have existed. And maybe this is the answer to the question that began this conversation. When Atlantis submerged pretty quickly, the sea levels rose and they lost everything, and they sent people, they sent survivors into what they called the four corners of the world with the knowledge that they had gained. They didn't have the tools, but they had the knowledge, and they tried to replicate that in with the materials and the tools that they had. So, so this may be the answer to the question, where did this knowledge come from? And it all links back to a catastrophic event that was not foreseen, even by an advanced civilization, that obviously they had the knowledge. They knew about the cosmos and the stars and our relationship to the stars. Where Antarctica may be a little bit different is it appears to have been even older than these other civilizations. And the indigenous traditions, the stories, the cultural stories, say that there was a link to our cosmic family through Antarctica. And there have been reports from people who have, you know, insiders that have come through, whistleblowers and things like that, that not only is there are the advanced structures, but possibly craft that were stuck in the ice, you know, when this happened. And if that's the case, then it implies technology that can be reverse engineered that could forever free us from the shackles of the fear and the lack and the scarcity of the kinds of technology that we're offered today. Things like finite, you know, all the technology is bringing us together right now. And the reason that the green revolution is not going to work is because it is based upon the use of 17 rare earth elements in just a couple of locations on Earth right now in nations that are not sometimes so friendly to the West. And it's a finite, it's a relatively small, it's a finite supply of these rare earth minerals to make the batteries, to make the copper, to make the solar panels and things like, they're good stepping stone. I think we need to embrace them to move to a more sustainable form, but they are not going to be the answer. And it could be that when we find whatever is hidden in Antarctica, that it offers that technology. And that might be one of the reasons why it's not being shared right now. It ties into disclosure. And the reason that all the disclosure is forthcoming, it's not so, I don't think anybody's surprised that we have a cosmic family. I mean, I think that's pretty broadly accepted. But the implications of an advanced technology and what it would mean to our world today, from my perspective, it could be a beautiful thing that frees us in a way that does just that. It allows sovereignty for the individual and for society. And that is in direct opposition to the attempts to subjugate and control that are being levied right now through technology. So, yeah.
Well, I mean,
long answer to a short question.
Well, I mean, and it's you know, if tomorrow morning someone woke up and said, "Oh, I discovered how we could get free energy," it would be stopped instantly. I mean, look, even the electric car in the early 2000s came out and it was working fine, and then they said, "No, this doesn't work with our business model," and they pulled it off the market. I mean, it's you know, the
you know, Alex, I'm going to say my first job out of college, I was hired. I was a geology major, geophysics major. I was hired in the industry without my degree initially, because I also had a parallel background in computer science. And in the 70s, that was pretty much unheard of. Computers were in, they took up a whole room. Very few people knew how to talk to a computer. And I was a pretty good programmer in the early programming languages. And I was hired by an energy company, and I finished my degree going nights once I was working there. One of the first things that I saw when I was there is that, you know, this was 1978, 79, is that there was a carburetor that would allow a gas guzzling vehicle to get over 90 miles to the gallon. And this was in the 1970s. And that carburetor threatened the energy industry, because if all of a sudden cars are getting 90 miles to the gallon, you're not going to use as much gas, sales are going to drop. So they bought up that patent and they sat on it. And to the best of my knowledge, they're still sitting on it. It has never, we're not using carburetors now. We have the same way, you know, we've got electronic ignition and different kinds of engines, but that was an example of where a technology was developed that threatened the status quo, and to subdue it, they just bought it outright and never used it. But this is where we are, and this conversation about the ancient civilizations, it's not happening in a vacuum. It is happening within the context of a crossroad. Here we are as a civilization at a crossroad where we're being threatened. The freedoms that allow our creativity and our intuition and our imagination to create great and beautiful things, to free us as a society, to free us as a species, those are all now facing the opposite, the technology that wants to control, that wants to take away the sovereignty that we've had for a lot of different reasons. And we're seeing this through social media, of course. We're seeing it through the transhuman movement, the movement that believes that we are flawed as a species, and that we need to replace our biology with artificial intelligence, with gadgets, with computer chips in the brain to be more efficient. All this is part of a bigger conversation. And I think what it invites all of us to do, we've all got to come to terms with what is it that we value, what values do we cherish as individuals, what values do we cherish as families, as communities, as societies, as nations, as a species. And we've got to claim those values now, because that is what is being threatened. And the hiding of the truth, the hiding of advanced technology, the hiding of our extraordinary potentials within our own bodies, super immune system, super cognition, super memory, super learning, all the things that we're told we need gadgets or we need chemicals to do. Our bodies do it even better. All the gadgets and the chemicals are mimicking what we already do in ourselves, except we do it better. Mm-hmm. And those are the kinds of things that are at stake right now. We're at this very, very powerful crossroad where it's not going to last forever. This is moving quickly in one generation. We either choose to cherish and value our humanness and our sovereignty and our freedom, or we're going to lose it as a species. And this is how you lose a species. We'll become a hybrid technology, biological species, where emotions are bred out of our existence because they're inefficient, where our memories that don't serve us become a thing of the distant past. This is exactly what the technology is doing now. And so the conversation about ancient civilizations is important, because it tells us we do have a history. We've been here longer than we've been led to believe. We've had advanced technology in the past. We had to see the kinds of things that we're seeing right now. And I think ultimately what it says is if we have had these in the past, and we as a species, if we have built great and beautiful things together as a species, and then something happened and we lost all of that, if we came together as a family, as a global family, how far could we go this time with everything that we have now? We've got all that we need to create the evolutionary edge so that we not just survive, that we thrive through all of the things that we're seeing right now, all of the war, all the climate change, all the social change, all the political change. But we've got to claim those values, I think, and make those values the foundation of all the policies and all the laws and all the choices. So that's my soapbox. And that's why I think the past is important, Alex, because if we don't know who we are and where we've come from, and we've made mistakes in the past, we're going to repeat those with the cycles as they come again.
Gregg, you know, I could talk to you for at least another 5 or 6 hours. Please promise to come back and we have another deep conversation about many of the things we kind of touched upon in this one.
Well, thank you. Well, I want to ask you, so you and I are having this conversation. Have you had this conversation with other guests?
I've dabbled in it, and it's an area that I want to start touching more upon, because my audience, based on our last conversations, which we touched upon certain aspects of it, we also talked about simulation theory and other things like that. It is something that people are super interested in and super fascinated in. And I think it's something that not only talks about our past as a species, but the implications spiritually that it has for everybody, and where we've been spiritually, where we've been in evolution of our soul and our spirituality throughout the, you know, hundreds of thousands of years, even. That is something I'm really interested in kind of diving in. We didn't even touch the spirituality aspect of all of this.
Well, so can we go till 10 after the hour?
Are you all right? Please. Oh yeah. I'm here as long as you like, sir.
No, I did a quick text. I apologize. I texted while you were speaking just to let my next interview know. I'd be a few minutes late.
Appreciate that.
When we talk about spirituality, it means different things, different people. And I think there's a deeper conversation that goes beyond spirituality and I'll mention and define it. It goes to our divinity. Mm-hmm. And when you look up the term, and I think we may have talked about this a little bit in our last conversation, when you look up the term divinity, a lot of people associate divinity with religion. And I can see why religion would have hijacked the term.
Sure.
But the term divinity, actually, if you look up the definition, it's interesting. It means the ability to transcend perceived human limitations. Our ability to not just survive, but to become more than, to thrive in the presence, beyond the limitations that we may have imposed upon ourselves in the past. What's happening today is there is a movement to keep us from our divinity, to keep us so that we feel that we are powerless victims of a world that we have no control over. And if you're a victim, it means you need a savior. And the savior that's being touted is technology. Mm-hmm. We're being taught, and our young people are being taught, all you need to do, you know, is to embrace this, you know, this piece of technology, this virtual reality or computer chip. There's a proposal now to implant computer chips into the brains of all newborns to give them the edge so they can compete successfully in the world today. What's being missed is that when our biology is replaced by technology, if you have a computer chip working for you, it means that your neurons think they're no longer needed, and your systems begin to atrophy. If you pump chemicals into your body for an immune response, your natural immune system says, maybe you don't need me anymore. The systems will begin to atrophy. You don't have the robust systems. And this is precisely what's happening today. And this is where we lose our sovereignty as an individual, because we feel that we need something outside of us. To be the best version of ourselves and to be successful in life. It's a very, very different way of thinking. And it's being done through really slick marketing. I mean, I'm aware of it, and I'm still in awe of how sexy the marketing is when I see the YouTube. You know, if you watch a YouTube video, you're going to get commercials, you know, while you're watching that video. And some of those commercials, if I were a young person and didn't know what I know now, I can see where they would be drawn to want to, you know, what's wrong with a computer chip in your brain or a special.
But it goes into that whole superhuman, superhero aspect of it. You're like becoming Iron Man. You're becoming Iron Man. And that's kind of the way they're positioning it.
Exactly. But this is where this is the battle that's coming down now for our divinity, because do you accomplish that by giving away your humanness to a technology, or do you accomplish that by developing the potential of human biology? We don't even know what that potential is. But this is where the spirituality comes in. When you replace biology with polymers, synthetics, AI, and computer chips, you have replaced DNA with artificial technology. The DNA is the link to our spirituality. The DNA is the link to our biology because our divinity, because the DNA, literally, DNA and the genes that make the DNA are literally antenna. They are soft antenna that tune us to information in a field of energy that scientists tell us underlies and connects all things. That is not controversial. Scientists are on board. There's a field underlying all existence, including us. We're in constant communication, non-verbally, through energetic transactions. Our DNA is picking up information. That's where intuition comes from. When you hear the voice in your head that says, this is a good thing to do, or this is not a good thing to do, or when you go into prayer and you ask for help and guidance and you receive that because it is coming through this energetic pathway. If we give away our biology to computer chips and synthetic technology, it might help in the moment. You're giving away your divinity, your access to your greatest potential, because now you're no longer able to communicate through these information pathways that we're only beginning to understand. You know, this is one of the reasons cloning technology, there's a mystery to cloning. Scientists in Dolly, the first sheep that was cloned, I mean, others had been done, but that was the first public clone, appeared to be successful at first. And then something mysterious happened. Her body began to break down and she died at about 50% of the age attained by her species. And it's not a one-off. All kinds of scientific articles are out there, peer-reviewed articles. They do this with cows. Now, bovine cloning for you know, they want to breed certain kinds of cattle.
Meat.
They clone them. At first, they look fine. They might produce a couple of offspring. They will not live their full lifespan. They begin to degenerate and break down from weird diseases. And here's what they've missed is in the cloning, there's a mismatch in the cloning. They take the ovum, they pull the DNA out and put in the DNA from another animal, but that DNA still has to communicate with the rest of the cell, and it can't because it is a different DNA from another animal. There's a mismatch. And that is an example of what happens to humans when we embrace and begin replacing biology. We're replacing our DNA with chips and wires and chemicals. We are actually limiting our potential. We're limiting our potential because we're losing the information pathway to our divinity. That's a huge statement. And the other part, and I've just saw a series of articles on this in the science journals. A computer chip, it's definitely fast, definitely efficient, definitely logic, much more logical maybe than human emotion. But that chip will always be limited by the physics of the stuff it's made from. Whereas a human neuron and the cell walls of a human, well, human cells, we are scalable. And what that means is that when our neurons, for example, when they reach what we used to think was the upper end of their ability to transmit information, now the neurons adapt and are able to begin transmitting higher speeds of more information than we ever thought was possible. We don't know the upper end of our scalability. We are a highly advanced, technologically sophisticated soft technology. And I talk about that a lot in other programs, the books, all kinds of YouTube videos. Soft technology. We're not chips and wires and chemicals. We're cell membranes and neurons moving ion potentials across the cell wall. And here's the beauty. You don't have to know any of it because we use thought, feeling, emotion, belief, breath, and focus. That's it. And this is what our ancestors always told. You don't have to know the tech because we're such an advanced tech. The interface is so simple. And that's the beautiful thing.
And we're so much more advanced than any technology that we, I mean, no one's been able to duplicate the insanity that is our body. It is our brain, how our brain works, how our cells work, how we're able to regenerate ourselves. None of it. And it sounds like from the cloning thing that you were saying that there is a failsafe in our system, that there's something in the creation of the process of what we are made of. There is a failsafe that you can't mess around with.
You said that so beautifully, Alex. Thank you. And you know, I'm a scientist and I believe in science. We've got to keep science honest if science is going to serve us. And science has been hijacked by politics, religion, corporations, technology. We ask science to tell us who we are. And science has done a good job. The question is, do we love ourselves enough? Do we love ourselves enough to accept the truth of what science is telling us? And the cloning experiments, I think, is one of the pathways that will lead science to understand and accept what it is that you and I are saying right now. If they are ever going to be successful in the cloning technology, they will have to accept that there's an information exchange that is happening within the cell to a field outside of the cell, and that there has to be a match of the antenna. So just to clarify, here's what I mean. In the cell, there's a nucleus of the cell. We know there's DNA in there. What a lot of people don't know is there is DNA outside of the nucleus, mitochondrial DNA. And so the DNA in the inside has to be able to communicate with the DNA outside. Some people are calling this junk DNA. Well, it's not junk. You know, it has a purpose. So I mean, just think about this. There's a communication, the DNA inside and outside the cell. So if you now take the DNA inside the cell, throw it away, and you bring in DNA from another animal, presumably the same species, but you put that in there, there's going to be a mismatch. These two can't talk to one another. They can't establish the information link, the resonant information link to the place in the field that allows them to be successful. And that's where the breakdown comes from. So when the scientific community, they will have to embrace this. Now, they'll never call it soul. They'll never call it spirit. They probably won't call it divinity, but it will lead them. They'll have to understand this if they're ever going to be successful with the cloning technology. So I think there is a place where we will meet with this kind of knowledge. And maybe this is the process. Maybe this is how it happens. I don't know. It's fascinating, isn't it?
It is. I mean, like I said, I could talk to you for hours, Gregg. And I think these conversations are so important because they are starting to plant seeds in people that might have never thought about these things because they've just been, you know, and you can go through, they swallow basically whatever they've been given. And I mean, you just go back to when I was growing up that egg yolks were good and whites were bad. And then they're like, no, we're kidding. Now the whites are good. Now the eggs are, yellows are bad. But now they're like, no, it's kind of like, so it's always just something as basic of an example as that. So you have to question. And nowadays, we're not just followers. There's so much information accessible to all of us, like these conversations, that we got to start asking questions about things that are mysterious. Even quantum physics The physics community doesn't even want to accept these ideas yet. And it's like, come on already, for God's sake.
Yeah, well, let's, you know, I just want to acknowledge to our viewers, we covered a lot of ground today at a high level, maybe didn't do it justice. Maybe we shouldn't have breached, you know, some of the topics, but they all really are part of the same conversation. Mm-hmm. And it's about us, our potential, our relationship to the world around us. And ultimately, it's about our ability and our willingness to love and honor the body that we have. The history is telling us about who we have been and what our potential is. So the battle for our story involves these ancient civilizations. And it's not like a little offshoot over here. I think it's central. Massive. To what's happening. And I really appreciate you. I had no idea. This is unscripted, obviously. I had no idea what we're going to talk about today. And I appreciate you choosing this particular topic, because I do think it's important. And maybe we laid the foundation for Alex and Gregg volume 3.
Yes, I hope so, my friend. We definitely got to get you back on the show. Gregg, I know you're a busy man. I know you got to go. Thank you so much for coming on the show. Is there anything, anywhere that if people want to find out more about you and the amazing work you're doing, where did it go?
You know, they, first of all, I have a dedicated YouTube channel so that the work cannot be sliced and diced and misrepresented as it is when it's not on that channel. Mm-hmm. So Gregg Braden on YouTube, there's only one official channel where we talk about a lot of these things in more detail and much more, as well as just go to the website, greggbraden.com, G-R-E-G-G, two G's, B-R-A-D-E-N.com, and trips to Peru, you know, speaking engagements all over the world, things like that. So Alex, thank you so much for the work you do. Thank you for your trust, my friend, and for sharing me with your community. I'm honored, and I look forward to part 3.
I appreciate you, my friend. Thank you again.
All right, thanks so much. Take care.
Thanks for watching. Click on one of the videos below to continue your journey, and don't forget to subscribe.